Good morning, Prince George Wignon, and welcome to the second Sunday of Easter. I feel compelled to remind everyone that while we're here with just a few of us, that we are going to do things a little bit differently than we do on Sunday mornings. Rest assured, when we get back in the building together, we will go back to our normal routines. One of the things that we're doing is each week we'll alternate between the 8 and 11 service and the 9 service. And so this morning we're going to be doing the 8 and the 11, and then next week we'll do the 9 and back and forth until we're all present and able to do them in a row. Two interesting things that I want to bring to your attention. First of all, this week after the service, you can click on the Sunday School. Adults, we will have Sunday School education beginning this Sunday, and it will last for 5 weeks, culminating with my wife, Sue, teaching the last class. We're using a book that's available through our church office or on Amazon. The details of all of this can be found on our website or in last week's e-news. And secondly, the bishop has given permission next Sunday for Eucharist, the host, to go to people's homes. We have a plan in place for the vestry members that want to deliver sealed Eucharist bags to the homes that would like the Eucharist. And then during the service, when it's time for Holy Communion, you can join me in taking it. It will be pre-consecrated. You won't be doing communion at home. You'll simply be taking communion that has been pre-consecrated, but it will be glorious, and I'm sure it'll be one step closer to all of us getting back together. So, if you would like to receive communion at home next week, call the church office and ask for Hosanna, or email Hosanna through the church website. It's my prayer that as we get closer to coming back together in this church, that you'll find this service and the ones that follow glorifying to God and uplifting in your spirits. Our service for Holy Eucharist begins on page 105 in the Book of Common Prayer. Please stand. Alleluia! Christ is risen!
Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Turning the page, join me in saying the Collect for Purity on 106.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Join me in saying the glory to God on page 107.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of God's Word.
The first reading today is from Acts chapter 2. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst. As you yourselves know, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosening the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David said concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is found in our lectionary insert, Psalm 111, and we will read by half verse responsibly. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks unto the Lord with my whole heart.
In the company of the upright and among the congregation.
The works of the Lord are great.
Sought out by all who have pleasure in them.
His work is worthy to be praised and held in honor.
And his righteousness endures forever.
He has made his marvelous works to be had in remembrance.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He has given food to those who fear him.
He shall ever be mindful of his covenant.
He has shown his people the power of his works,
that he may give them the heritage of the nations.
The works of his hands are faithfulness and justice.
All his commandments are true.
They stand fast forever and ever,
and are done in truth and equity.
He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever.
Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
A good understanding have all those who live accordingly. His praise endures forever.
Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The second reading is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior according to St. John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas this time was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Pray with me, please. Come, Spirit of the living God, come and fall now again, anew, and refresh this place. Lord, refresh these words. Fill them with your power. Send them out to your people, Lord. We long to hear your voice. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning's sermon is about two things. And it's a simple sermon, I hope, and it's a shorter sermon, I hope. I know that will make some at home smile. Your coffee won't get cold, hopefully, by the time this sermon is over. The sermon's about faith, and the sermon is about doubt. As Muff read this morning from our first Peter reading, Peter, talking to hearers and followers of Jesus down through the ages, says this about our faith. About our faith. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, or every once in a while. If necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, hang on to this, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Peter's saying that our faith will be tested. Peter's making the point that our faith is not continually on. Just like when we leave today and we're going to turn these lights out, the electricity's still coming to the building, the switch has just been turned off. Peter is saying our faith is a lot like that. It's not a continuous faith, just like we're not capable of continuous love. I said that in an earlier sermon. Our faith gets interrupted, our faith gets tested, and our faith at times is confronted by doubt. So I want us to hold that in our minds when we rehear the gospel story. Because I think far too often, Thomas gets short shrift. I think many of us who are sitting in church or sitting at home, we've turned on the TV, we're watching, we're worshiping, we're feeling pretty good about ourselves. We're thinking, well, I'm not a doubter. Look, I'm here with my children, I've got coffee, we're doing the work. Many of us listen to this gospel and we think, oh, Thomas, boy, oh boy, what a doubter. What Jesus says to Thomas, though, and what I hope to bring out this morning, is not that we'll never doubt again. Peter says the same thing. It's not that we'll never doubt again, but that in our doubting, when Jesus appears, our faith will be strengthened so that in the day, listen to this again, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ, at the moment we see Jesus face to face, just like Thomas did. My Lord and my God, he says. Of course he said that. What else would we say? What else will we say? My Lord and my God, it's the appropriate response. So this morning, I just want to hold up doubt and faith for a minute and compare them and contrast them. There was a play that got turned into a movie called Doubt. Philip Seymour Hoffman and the great Meryl Streep were in the movie. And the play was about a Catholic school, a Catholic elementary school, where a father, a priest, was accused of malfeasance or inappropriate behavior with a child, the only black student in the school. It was inner city Boston. And the play was magnificent because what it did was, every time it shifted scenes, is it had a sermon from Father Flynn. That was the Hoffman character. And Father Flynn, as he was being confronted by the Mother Superior, Meryl Streep, again and again brought up sermons that pushed back against the doubt of himself. And it was a great movie. It climaxes at the very end when Meryl Streep, the Mother Superior, confesses to a younger nun that she had actually made up a story to get the father transferred. That she had actually lied because she was so certain he had done what he had been accused of, that she created a lie to get him to leave. And at the very end of the movie, she's crying and the other young nun is crying, and she looks at the other nun and she says something like, "And yet I have my doubts." It's one of those moments where I think the inside of our heart gets pricked. It's one of those moments where we can remember times in our life where we were so certain about something. I know I put the keys here, only to have our spouse or our children say, "No, they're still in the ignition." It's one of those moments where her doubt is being confronted and she's exposed to someone else and realizes that maybe her doubt was not founded. Doubt's the oldest tool in the devil's tool chest. The devil's been using doubt. It's the first thing he uses. When he comes onto the scene in Genesis chapter 3, the first thing he does is sow seeds of doubt. Genesis 3. "Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, 'Did God actually say, doubt, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" We need to remember that when we're hearing about the devil, he can't create anything. He is not equal to our creator God. All the devil can ever do is take what God has already made and manipulate it or pervert it. So it's his oldest trick to take what God says and pervert it or cast doubt on it. Did God really say that? It's doubt, pure and simple. And I think we can all relate to that Genesis scene and to the movie. I believe, that we're pretty certain when we decide to make a judgment. Harry this morning read beautifully, and he's an attorney, and I finished a book last year by Malcolm Gladwell called Speaking to Strangers. And one of the things Gladwell brings out is we're actually bad judges of character when we look people in the eye. He took several appellate court judges, and he looked at the record that they had of getting the sentence correct, meaning sentencing somebody or giving them probation versus their likelihood to go back into crime, to be recidivists. And what he found was that 7 out of 10 times the judges got it wrong. The judges, however, every time demanded to see the person they were about to sentence, because the judges were certain, like all of us, I'm not coming down the judges, that if we can just look somebody straight in the eye, we'll know what they're thinking. We'll know what's in their heart. And the computer program, on the other hand, took all the information about these accused, put it into the database, went through it all, and came up with a verdict of either, yes, this person is likely to go back into crime, or no, this person won't, and got it right 9 out of 10 times. The computer that never saw a human face. It's crazy if we are certain we're right, even when we can be found out to be wrong later. So I want to give Thomas just a little break here. And I want to get the heart of Jesus' forgiveness for Thomas, and I want to look at how Jesus cures it. He does it three ways. Jesus does it three ways. Notice in the gospel that when Jesus comes the second time, and I would expect the other disciples, if I was them, I just have to be honest, as soon as Jesus walked through the door the second time, I'd be one of the ones in the back going, "Thomas is going to get it now. Here he comes," because as we heard, the doors are locked. Jesus comes through the door and he says the same thing he said the week before. So I can imagine the music kind of building in the background as Thomas is probably shaking as Jesus comes to him. Notice the first point. What Jesus does is not he doesn't raise his voice. He doesn't walk through the wall and go, "What, Thomas? You didn't believe?" He doesn't admonish him. He doesn't go, "Thomas, you of all people, I called you early on. You've been with me a long time." He doesn't do that. He doesn't shame him. He doesn't go, "You know, Judas, I would have expected. But you, Thomas, not you." We do that to people sometimes, don't we? Or, I think the most common thing we do when confronted with someone who's doubted us is we give them the cold shoulder, the silent treatment. Jesus doesn't walk into the room, look at Thomas, and kind of go, "Huh," and then walk out. No. The first thing Jesus does with our doubts in the coronavirus times, in war times, is he confronts our doubts head on. He challenges the lie that we're being told by our minds or our friends, think Job or the devil. That's why the first thing we need to do when we doubt, or when doubt begins to creep in, is to call on the Lord. It can be in our cars, it can be in our offices. We need to beg him to come into our lives and remind us of his truth. We need to get back to the Word of God. Most importantly, we need to return to the community of God. We need to reach out to one another, especially in this coronavirus time. Your vestry has done a magnificent job calling people on our church roster and just touching base.
and just letting them know, have no doubt, the church is still there. The church is still being led. We will get back together one day, dispelling, pushing out those moments of doubt. The last way I'd say to push out doubt is to go out and serve someone else. If you're deep in a moment of doubt, go out and do something for someone else. And I know some of us can't leave our homes or can't get out, but all of us can pray. All of us can pick people in our lives and begin to pray for them. All of us, or some of us, could email them. Most of us could pick up a phone and call them. But praying in doubt or serving in the midst of doubt always eases our tension and reminds us that God is in control no matter how things look, how dire the situation looks from our perspective. Jesus will comfort our doubts if we call on him. So secondly, not only does he confront the doubt and provide visual proof of his love, he comes closer to us in our moments of doubt. Notice again in the gospel what Jesus does. After coming through the wall, after pronouncing peace on all of them, he locks eyes on Thomas. And I imagine he takes a step or two closer to Thomas. He gets within arm's reach of him. No coronavirus fear there. And he says, Thomas, put your hands here. Listen to the words again. Thomas, he says his name. Put your finger here and see my hands. The blood dripping, the blood stained puncture wounds of the nails. And then here's the thing. Put your hand in my side. Put your hand in my side. He's not telling Thomas, get away from me. He's not giving him the cold shoulder. He's drawing nearer to Thomas. And the only thing Thomas at this moment, we should all be reminded of, that he's doubting, is the resurrection. Thomas isn't doubting that Jesus is who he says he is in terms of being the Messiah. Thomas isn't doubting that he fed 5,000 people. Thomas isn't doubting that he calmed the waves and the storm. Thomas isn't doubting a lot of things. At that moment, the only thing he's doubting, like the light switch that's been turned off for a second, is that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Can we blame him? Can we blame him? Thomas needs help taking this next step of faith. It's what Duff read this morning in Peter. Thomas's faith is being tested at this moment. Jesus is going to come to him. Jesus is going to strengthen his faith. Jesus is going to help him in his unbelief. Remember these words in Mark's gospel to the man who had a son that was sick. This is Mark chapter 9. And someone from the crowd answered him, Teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams, and he grinds his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast out the demon, and they were not able. And Jesus answered them, O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me. There's that second piece. Jesus wants to get close to this boy. And they brought the boy to him. And when the spirit saw him, the spirit of the demon inside of that boy saw Jesus, looked at him, my Lord and my God, that spirit said to himself. Immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground, and he rolled about foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, how long has this been happening to him? Notice Jesus isn't worried. He's getting ready to take action. Those are those dark moments in the coronavirus times, or dark moments when we haven't heard from our children. Jesus isn't worried. Call to Jesus. And the father answered, from childhood, and it's often cast him into the fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us, I'm sure he means his mother and I, and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can, all things are possible for one who believes. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, and this is what Thomas is saying in his heart at that very moment, I believe, help my unbelief. In other words, Lord, come in your power and your great might and conquer my unbelief at this moment. Speak, Lord, act, Lord. And he does, and he comes closer to us. There's a Caravaggio painting that hangs in Potsdam, Germany. Many of you have seen it. It's beautiful. It's oil on canvas, and it's a picture of doubting Thomas. The title of it is The Incredulity of Thomas. It was painted in the 1600s. And it shows the Apostle Thomas reaching his hand, or having his hand guided into the open wound of Jesus' side from the spear that was thrust into him by the centurion. It's a powerful image. It's so powerful that I ordered the print. I'm going to hang it in my office. Because I believe we all need to have a Thomas moment again and again and again with our faith. We all need to be taken to places of doubt by the world and then have Jesus confront those moments of doubt so that doubt can be dropped and we can put our faith, renew our faith, graft our faith deeper into Jesus, because he confronts it and he'll come closer to us in our moment of doubt. And finally, Jesus has promised, based on his truth, if we'll trust him, if we'll suspend our doubt, he will give us the power to believe. It's that funny story of the tightrope walker who strung up a tightrope across two buildings in New York City, 100 stories in the air, and gathered people in the newspapers, and he began to walk back and forth across this tightrope, suspended in the air, no net, 100 stories up. And one time he went across with a little goblet of champagne, and one time he went across carrying a plate. And after about the third or fourth time across, he grabbed a wheelbarrow. And he looked at the crowd and he said, "How many of you believe I can take this wheelbarrow across this tightrope?" And they all went, we believe. He said, "Okay, who's getting in?" There's the difference between belief and faith. I believe he's going to make it across that high wire. I just don't have enough faith in him that I'm willing to get in that wheelbarrow. That's what Jesus is doing for Thomas, and that's what Jesus will do to each one of us. And that's what those words mean. Blessed are they who have not yet seen and believe. He's not saying that those of us who've never seen Jesus face to face have a superpower, or that somehow we're better than Thomas. No, Jesus is saying something about his power in helping us to believe today. It doesn't mean that we'll never doubt again. No, it's actually something better. What Jesus is saying is, each time we choose to call on him in our moments of doubt, each time we let him come and comfort our doubts, he'll strengthen our conviction of who he is and how deeply we can trust him. People are waking up at 7 a.m. on Friday to come film the service. They have faith. So that by the time we see him face to face, as Duff read, and he says our name, he says Harry, he says Duff, he says Jeremy, we, like Thomas, will say, "My Lord and my God." And all of our doubts will have been turned into belief. Amen.
Our service continues on page 109. Please join me in saying the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son to worship and glorify, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are found on page 110 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray for the church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy word to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We humbly ask you for mercy to receive our prayers. Inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that you will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness and so guide and direct their leaders, especially Donald, our president, Henry, our governor, and our local officials, that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant that our leaders may impartially administer justice, uphold integrity, truth, restrain wickedness and vice, and protect true religion and virtue. In your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Lord, give grace, heavenly people, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially Foley Beach, Archbishop of the Anglican Church in North America, Bishop Mark Lawrence, Fitz Allison, Bishop in Residence, Gary, our rector, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation, that by their life and teaching, they may proclaim your true and life-giving word and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. And to all your people, give your heavenly grace, especially in this congregation, that with reverent and obedient hearts, we may hear and receive your holy word and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prosper, we pray, all those who proclaim the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world, and strengthen us to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask you in your goodness, O Lord, to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, especially for our parish prayer list: Olga Abbott, Joyce Bourne, Susan Boyette, Michael Donnelly, Jerry Duff, Faith Dyer, Ed Grant, Tiffany Harris, Dale Hicks, Eliza Jagger, Mrs. Lee Jones, Sharon Miller, Roger Maurer, Harold Ness, Pat Noft, Joanne Sasser, Marilyn Sinclair, Pat Stalvey, Joe and Sally Steen, Emily West, Janet Williams, and Zella Wilt, and also for the friends and family of Prince George Church, for Alan, Bill, Billy, Cheryl, Chip, Christine, Cookie, Dale, Dean, Debbie, Eleanor, Jerry, Jeffrey, Jonathan, Julie, Lynn, Lily, Mike, Nick, Robert, Stephen, Susan, Tim, Tootie, Virginia, and Walter. And for all of those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving, let us pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
A prayer in time of great sickness and mortality. O most merciful and mighty God, in this time of grievous sickness, we flee to you for relief. Deliver us, we ask you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means used for their cure. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. All who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and seek to live in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you all, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Please stand. Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Greet one another with an air wave or a holy hello.
Oh, the power to redeem.
Our service of Holy Communion begins on page 115 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is our right, our duty, and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who was offered for us and has taken away the sins of the world, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You may kneel or stand or be seated. All praise and glory is yours, O God, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted, and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue, a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. So now, O merciful Father, in your great goodness, we ask you to bless and sanctify with your word and Holy Spirit these gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his body and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. For on the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, your humble servants, celebrate and make here before your divine majesty with these holy gifts the memorial your Son has commanded us to make, remembering his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. And we earnestly desire your fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, asking you to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and our bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. We humbly pray that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction, and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy because of our many sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we ask you to accept this duty and service we owe, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah! Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us once and for all.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Join me in saying the prayer of humble access on page 119. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood,
that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. O Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
Brothers and sisters, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ Jesus died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Amen. This is the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. This is the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Join me in turning to page 677 and saying the prayer for spiritual communion. Prayer number 106 on page 677. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, gathered around every altar of your church, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Now join me in saying our post-communion prayer on page 121. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us through this sacrament of your favor and goodness towards us, that we are true members of the mystical body of your Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of your everlasting kingdom. And we humbly ask you, Heavenly Father, to assist us with your grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all the good works that you have prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to him with you and the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God, and especially of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us all, remain with us this day until we get together again. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia.